After 24 national selections and 13 internal selections, we now have all 37 songs for this year's Eurovision Song Contest. From this point onward is where the speculation begins, and just about every aspect of the results are going to be discussed. Naturally, who's going to win? Who's going to qualify for the grand final? Who's going to do better than expected? And who won't? Now, a lot of this is discussed with only a fraction of the information. The big missing piece is how these songs are actually gonna look on stage, which is so important to really get a sense of what we're gonna be seeing. For that reason, today's video is gonna be more of an overview of the entries rather than getting into the specifics about who's gonna qualify, who's gonna make it into the top 10, so on and so forth. For the time being, let's talk about which countries are really bringing their A game this year. If you ask me, there are three songs this year that are doing something very special. I would like to think that this is going to be our top three. Obviously, anything can change by the time we actually get to the show, but I do think that there's something special about each of these, and it's a very highly commendable effort regardless of what the eventual result is. This first one is not going to be everyone's choice for a top three contender, but if you ask me, there's lots of evidence here to suggest that this is going to be really competitive. What an incredible work of art we're getting from Spain this year. I'm so happy that we get to see something like this that's very clearly tapping into Spanish culture, but demonstrating it in a way that's innovative and complex. It really has so much going for it. It's visually well-crafted, it's musically distinct, and the performance, like, come on. Now, despite the fact that there's a really strong sense of artistry behind this performance, it is worthwhile to mention that that's not always what motivates the voters, especially when you consider the fact that this is one of the songs with the least amount of pop music qualities to it. And so it is possible that it won't have the same profound effect that it had at Benidorm Fest. But it's my belief that it will. I think this could very easily be a Barbara Pravi moment, a Goé moment, a Constracta moment, and I think it's gonna be recognized in a substantial way. And even if it isn't, I think it's an entry to be really proud of. So that's the first one. The next two are more obvious choices, but for good reason, because it's looking more and more like a two-horse race for the win this year. Finland has the entry that I think is going to be bringing the most fun, which says a lot when you consider the fact that this year is so high energy and so, like, loud overall. I see this as the best way to combine the old ideas of what Eurovision is with the newer ones, where, yeah, the performance is a bit silly and out there, but underneath it all, you have a song that has a ton of character and is giving the viewers an experience that they're not going to get anywhere else. And more, I am pleasantly surprised by how many people are appreciating Finland, because on paper, you would think that this kind of entry would be niche. But with the combination of all the factors, it just works. This is a very likely contender to win the televote, and that makes it also a very likely winner of the overall show. But the obvious area of doubt is how well is this going to do with the juries. Now that we have all the songs, I'm very confident that this will get a respectable jury score. It's not going to be the jury favorite, but it should keep them within reach of a win. But of course, they're not the only ones, and that leads us to our last choice here, which is the big one. What more can we say about Sweden? Loreen is bringing a powerful and anthemic song that has really caused such a storm ever since it debuted. This is the most obvious contender for the win, and I don't think that anyone that's seriously looking at the overall competition has any doubt about that. With that said, there's a huge magnifying glass under Loreen that works both for and against her, and because she's such a big figure in Eurovision, that was always going to be the case. Also, there have been some concerns about how the Melody Festival and performance will be adapted for the Liverpool stage, because the screen is said to be too heavy for the roof to support, and therefore they might have to come up with a completely new idea, which will inevitably be compared to the old one, probably in a negative way. The point is, there's going to be a lot of complaining about this, and most of that discussion will be irrelevant to whether or not this is actually going to win. The real make or break factor, I believe, is going to be how much people are going to buy into this kind of schlager trance hybrid. And I say that as somebody who listened to a lot of trance music growing up and tried to get other people to be as excited about it as I was. I know better than most people that it's just not for everyone, and that could be the case here. But whether or not you like the song, or whether or not you remember Loreen from a decade ago, you will not forget this performance. And a lot of the reason for that is Loreen herself. It's not her hype that's selling the song, it's her. And that is also what I consider to be what ties all three of these songs together. They're all performed by artists that can't be easily defined. They all have such a strong identity, and I think that's going to be what propels them to the top. Now, another thing that these entries all have in common is that they all came from national selections, so we have a pretty good idea of what their impact is on television. So what about the internally selected songs? Which ones have the best chances at possibly winning or doing really well in the competition? There are a few here that I could see entering this sphere of upper tier artists, but there's one especially that has really caught my attention.
Who the hell is this?
Austria was overdue, if you ask me, to bring something that was going to get a lot of people excited. And they seem to have done that with a song that is truly unique. To have something that is so fun and such an earworm, but at the same time also has this commentary about the music industry and how hard it is to make a living as an artist is really great. I think there's a lot of potential in this one. The question is obviously, how is this going to look on stage? And could a song like this that already has so much buzz behind it be compromised by a weak performance or weak staging? The answer is yes, as it would be for most entries, but I actually think the chances are pretty good given how much character this song has, and I think it would take a lot to really ruin it, at least when it comes to qualifying. For top 10, top 5, that could be a different story. It's also worth noting that there appears to be quite a difference between the quality of music in the two semifinals, and this one is in the supposedly weaker one. Like many people, I don't see a lot of competition in semifinal 2. So, if they play their cards right, this could be the semifinal winner. And if that happens, they'll be most likely to also get a good score in the final. Anyway, I'm quite excited for this one, and I'm really hoping that it could do well, just like I am for this other one that's one country over and very different. Slovenia is not usually a country that people have on their radar at Eurovision. I'd say that more often than not, they have good quality entries, but sometimes they're lacking a competitive edge. This year, however, I'd say that Slovenia is more competitive than they've ever been. Joker Out is bringing a style of rock that never goes out of fashion, and doing so in a pretty effective way. It's a little reminiscent of what Måneskin brought, but with a different vibe. It's more laid back and inviting than most of the rock entries that we've seen. And if you haven't seen the live performance in full, you really should, because I think that is what convinced me that Slovenia is going to be one to watch this year. And so if they're able to bring that same energy to the stage in Liverpool, then I have no doubts that this would be a really strong finish for Slovenia, possibly even their best ever. Now that's just 5 songs, and I suppose that you could call that my current idea of who's most likely to land in the top 5. This next group of songs that we're going to talk about are ones that are also gaining traction online. Some people might have more faith in these songs finishing higher. For me, it's mostly a mixed bag. I could certainly see some of them finishing pretty high over others, and that would be the kind of thing that there would be more certainty about when the show gets closer. Norway has been among the more popular entries this year, getting a lot of fan support and also having a life on TikTok. This is the kind of song that a lot of people still come to Eurovision for, where it's a big dance pop number with a powerful vocal performance, and it also has that theme of female empowerment to go with it as well. Because of that, I don't really see any reason why people wouldn't vote for this. But I suppose the question is, if this is seen as quite a typical Eurovision entry, will people vote for this in big numbers, or will they be more interested in something that feels new? Given the performance that we saw at MGP, I feel more inclined to say that this will still get a good score regardless, However, I think that this could be elevated in a way that really sells it quite well, because what we have right now is pretty straightforward. Rather than having the dancers simply fill out the background, what I would like to see is some interaction between them and Alessandra so that she can kind of convey this idea of power that she, the character in this song, has over them. I just see it as a way of showing more than telling. But speaking of female empowerment, Czechia's My Sister's Crown is another one that's caused a lot of excitement and is polling quite well. It seems like the thing that a lot of people appreciate about this song is this theme of unity and the way that they express it through all the different languages that they combine in the song. For other people, it's a point of criticism because they believe that this idea of Slavic sisterhood is the same justification that Russia has been using to invade Ukraine and claim it as their own. That's something that I don't think should be taken lightly. I think it's a pretty fair point, but it also doesn't mean that we have to be black and white about our judgments of the band or the intentions of what they were actually trying to do. For me, this is a very big let's wait and see because it's been a month and a half and I still can't decide how I feel about the song. There's certain aspects of it that I like the dark sound of it. There are other sides that I'm not that big of a fan of, like some of the lyrical choices, and I just find myself kind of uncertain of what to say. With that said, I do really like what Czechia brings to Eurovision, and this entry is certainly in line with their identity for not being afraid to be a bit alternative. And they've also shown that they can really elevate their entries with staging, so I could see myself coming around to liking this. France's song is another one that's earned a lot of popularity, and I think it's pretty easy to see why. I mean, look at her. Her appearance alone makes her like a Eurofan's wet dream. Metaphorically speaking. The song itself also just ticks so many boxes for what Euro fans like. You know, girl bop, glamorous, disco beat, it's all there. As for the larger audience, I do think that the femininity and elegance is a big selling point, but the live show can't be built around that exclusively. It still needs to be an experience. And if they want this to be a competitive entry, I don't think that there's like an obvious way for this to be staged. Nonetheless, I do find it to be a pretty enjoyable song. It's very easy on the ears, and it could certainly have a lot of potential if they find the right way to present this. Italy is often a country that's expected to do well at Eurovision, and I don't think that this year would be all that different, especially now that we know that Marco is taking Due Vite to Liverpool. At a surface level, it's a pretty typical Italian entry, still a beautifully composed song, but not one that people are going to be watching and thinking that they're experiencing something new. It's not like a soldi, let's say. For that reason, I think it's pretty safe to say that this is out of the running for like top 3 or top 5. But beyond that, I don't think there's any reason to believe that this would underperform for what Italy usually expects. I think it could still very easily land in the top 10 because people love Italian ballads, man. Estonia is another one that I think could have a shot at the top 10. I know we just talked about Italy, but when we look at the whole competition, there aren't actually that many ballads this year. And this is the only one that has a really stripped back instrumentation that's very classic and timeless sounding, paired with a very dramatic vocal performance. These songs are often thought about as being more appealing to the jury than the televote, with a few exceptions. And because of that, it has made people wonder about how this could play out with the juries in the semifinals being completely scrapped. Again, this is in semifinal 2, which is thought of as the weaker semifinal, so I have very little concern about that being an issue here. In the grand final, we could certainly see that discrepancy between the jury vote and the televote, but it might not even be that big if it has a more profound effect than that of Italy or whatever other ballad makes it out of the semifinal. One that seems to be landing in the middle for most people that I'm gonna put in here as one that has strong top 10 potential is Australia. The reason why I have a lot of confidence in this is because I think a lot about the performance that we saw last year at Australia Decides, where Voyager finished in second place with the song Dreamer also being the televote winner. What I see when I watch them on stage is a band that loves what they do. They're so into the performance and they're really feeding off the energy of the crowd. That's a huge advantage if you ask me. And on top of that, they're bringing a sound that's not that comparable to other bands that we have here. So I suppose you could consider this a dark horse from my point of view. I think that this could go very far. Last but not least, we have our reigning champions, Ukraine. Talking about Ukraine at Eurovision with the war in the background is always going to be a challenge because some people are still cynical. They don't believe that the song or the performance has any role in their success. They say it's all about sympathy and that we should expect the score to be exactly like last year. I wish that we could treat this entry just like any other. But because of this fear, what I will say is that I think the circumstances in May 2023 are going to be very different from the ones in May 2022. The war is still top of mind for all of Europe, but we've seen a tremendous amount of resistance from Ukraine. They are still the victims of this terrible war, but they've proven to be far from helpless. And so, yes, this could end up being one of the televote favorites, but I don't think it would be entirely unearned because the song is reflecting that resilience, and that might be the mood on the night. In any case, there's no guarantee about anything, and hopefully those cynics will come around and just kind of accept things as they play out. I'm happy that we still have Ukraine in the contest because it would not be the same without them. So those are the ones that I consider to be the standouts. Later on, there will be others that emerge, but again, this is just an overview and we'll wait and see how things play out before the show. Now, naturally, if we're talking about who's standing out, the follow-up to that is who's not. Well, I mean, there's weak songs this year, there's weak songs every year, and the thing is, I don't think that any of them are truly dead on arrival when it comes to qualification, but some of them will be fighting an uphill battle, and I think the most obvious one is Ireland. The reason is because it's a combination of the song just being such an outdated idea of what people vote for at Eurovision, and it being in the more competitive semi-final. I really can't see that many people preferring this song over others. If they're able to play into their stadium rock sound and make the arena come alive, they could make it through to qualify to the final. But once they get there, I doubt that they would make a big dent in the score and they could potentially finish last. Another one would be San Marino. And I say this as someone who actually likes the song. I like the fact that it sounds more like something you would hear at like a local bar or a music festival rather than Eurovision. That's likely the reason why this isn't registering with Euro fans, and I don't mean to say that it's like amazing and it's being completely overlooked, but it doesn't surprise me that it's ranking so low. It is worth noting that we don't yet have a studio cut of this song, which leaves the door open for impressions to change. Whether or not they would change enough for the fans to get behind this, I don't really think so, because again, it's the nature of the song that I think isn't clicking with them. But it could actually cement this as something that's a bit better than people are realizing. There's another one that I also really like, and it seems that it has a very dedicated fan base, but I do feel like the path to qualification is very slim, and that's Latvia. It's a very cool entry if you ask me, and it brings diversity to the year, even when considering where it fits among the rock bands. But the reason why I feel like it's going to be fighting an uphill battle is really a mixture of what's working against San Marino and Ireland. The fact that it's probably a bit too niche for a large audience, and also that it's in this really competitive first semi-final. I want to be wrong about this, I really do, especially for Latvia's sake, because it's been so long since they've been in the final. But I also wanted to be wrong about Slovenia and Georgia from last year, who both finished in last place in their semi-finals for what I believe to be very similar reasons. Romania would be another one that I think is heading towards not qualifying. Theodore is clearly a very talented singer, and the song that he's bringing has very interesting musical elements to it, but I still think that it's just a hard sell, and I don't think that if they're going to be doing anything of what they did on stage at the Romanian national selection, that that's going to do them any favors. There are clearly some meaningful ideas there, but they're not coming together, and without that, I think this entry risks coming off as self-indulgent. There are some others that also don't look like they have great chances, but these are the ones that I would say I'm most concerned about. The rest are kind of landing in the middle, and again, this is just an overview. There's a lot more for us to find out, and so we'll wait until then before we actually decide. But to wrap things up, I want to talk about which songs could surprise, which ones are flying under the radar that could end up doing really well. Well, let's talk about Belgium, because now that we have a bigger picture of what semi-final 2 looks like, I think this is flying through to the final. The song is fun, it's uplifting, and Gustav sells the hell out of it. The only area of doubt is the aesthetics, and as long as they ditch the wardrobe and go with something else that fits the kind of 90s black and white theme, then this is gonna give people that real big dose of nostalgia, and I think people could really respond to it. Another one that I think might surprise is Malta, who, when it looked like they had very few options in their national selection, ended up choosing, I think, the best one. The boys from the Busker managed to make something out of very little, and what I mean by that is that their staging was very clearly low budget, but they made it work. And if they're able to bring that same level of creativity that they had then and that they have in their music video, then I think this could be really great. And then lastly, there's one song that I just couldn't figure out where to place in this discussion because it's not flying under the radar, it's not in contention to win, but it's also not going to be forgotten. It's this one. Croatia is bringing the ultimate Marmite song. You either like it or you don't. And I happen to be on the side of liking it. This is the closest thing that we have to real punk rock, or at least like music that has a rebellious spirit. They're not here to make you feel good. They're here to make a point about something that's going on in the world. And they're responding to the anger that a lot of people are feeling with a song that mocks the individual who is responsible. You can complain about this being political all you want, but if you're seriously looking at the competition, what it's been for all these years, and the values that it represents, they are political. As far as I see it, this is an extension of those same values. It's just being presented in a different way that isn't warm and fuzzy. Now, as a band, they are known for being a bit unhinged, and it is possible that they could take things too far to the point where it's off-putting, and if that happens, they should definitely stay in the semifinals. But I think with the right balance, people could respond to this in a really big way, and especially if they're able to bring a sense of relief in a situation that feels really hopeless, that could work very well, and this would actually be a very, very impactful entry. Anyway, that song deserves a video of its own, and as I've now covered about half the songs for Eurovision 2023, I think we should leave it there. Thank you so much for watching. If you haven't done so already, please subscribe to the channel because we are talking about Eurovision as it approaches, and I'd love to know what you have to say about the show. Don't forget to leave a comment about which songs you think are on track for a good score, which ones you think might surprise, and which ones you think might fall short. I'd love to know what you have to say. I hope to see you on the next video. Take care.